Good evening. Bezrat Hashem, next week we'll try to keep it 9 o'clock sharp, because now the davening become earlier, 10 minutes. I'll be able to be here on time, Bezrat Hashem. I'm very happy we moved here. I didn't know we have this big, beautiful synagogue. Last week we did it in the front. So Baruch Hashem, there's more room for more people to come. And we're continuing the Talmud series in English. Last week, we spoke about the last mitzvah, was number 94. We spoke about that as a nation of God, we have no permission to leave idols worshiper in the land of Israel. Which means that when we enter the land, from that moment on, we have an obligation to clean any memory of them. Not to leave any souvenir, not statues, not the places where it was, not their buildings, anything like that. Which means, if today there would be the arrival of the Mashiach, first thing we will have to remove is any symbol relates to Christianity. Because Christianity is idol worshiping. You understand, even though the idol is a person, they worship a person, but still, idol can be anything. Can be an animal, can be a person, can be a statue, can be a picture, can be an idea. So basically an idol could be anything but Hashem. Anything that it's not Hashem directly. And even us as a Jew, when we pray to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, we're not allowed to imagine any image. Not allowed to imagine light. We're not allowed to imagine letters, the letters of how we write Hashem. We're not allowed to imagine any color or any image or any shape or anything like that. Why? Because one of the principles of Judaism that Hashem doesn't have any image. And it's obviously it's a superpower. He runs the world. He created the world. But we cannot imagine him in any way. El mi tedamyuni ve'eshve, Hashem said. He said, no matter how you imagine me, it will never be correct. Any kind of imagine that a human being can imagine God will be incorrect. That's why don't bother. Now, you may say, well, okay, so it helps me to concentrate. You know, big deal, I won't imagine the right God. I imagine something else. I imagine light, I imagine color, I imagine whatever. But at least, you know, it's all fine. I'm not imagining the right God, but it helps me. No, that's the whole thing, that it becomes a sin. Once a person imagine God as a physical image, then it's already a sin. Now, not to talk about taking a human being, which besides the point was a big sinner, that makes sins against the Torah and against the Chachamim, even though he never started Christianity, but still, it's an idol. Worshipping this idol. There are Jews also worshipping idols. We spoke about it last week. They take a holy rabbi. The rabbi is holy. But the followers who worship that rabbi are idols worshippers. And according to Rav Shach, which was the leader of the religious world, some of them cannot participate in any holy ceremony, which means cannot count them in a minyan, even though they shomer Shabbos, they eat kosher, they make bracha, they give charity, they make kiruv, they do all kinds of things, this kind of idol worshippers. But Rav Shach in Ponovich Yeshiva was the leader of the religious world, of all religious people. He said that people who worship a person, and this is the real God for them, this is who they're afraid of, this is who they follow, whatever he tells them they do, regardless if the Torah says the opposite. These kind of people are dangerous to Judaism. You should know, there is a thick book in Judaism, it's called False Messiahs. It didn't start in our time that some kind of people think that their rabbi is the holiest in the world and he's the Messiah. It's been taking place for already more than 2,000 years. Every once in a while, a group of Jews decided to make a king, a Messiah in Yemen, in Europe, Shabtai Tzvi, and all the rest of the story. So now when we come to Israel, since we don't have permission to be like this, first thing, we got to clean the land from all this despicable idol worshiping. And don't give them permission to even live in Israel. Even if they surrender, And they say, okay, destroyed our places, destroyed all our idols, destroyed the statues, destroyed whatever. Fine, we understand. The Messiah come, you are the leader of the land. Even when the Mashiach doesn't come, when it's an established Jewish area, Jewish religion government, which means according to the Torah, according to the Torah, there's no permission to let any, we won't be able to give a visa to any missionary, any Christian missionary. I just want to tell you, like on Friday, I got an email. I wish I had the time to read it to you. Maybe on another time we'll do it. In Hebrew, I opened the email, it was Friday afternoon. I don't know, of course, when you get an email, you don't know where it comes from. You don't know America, Israel, Europe, can be from all over the world. And there's a, right away I saw is a Christian person, but writes perfect Hebrew, intellectual level. So he writes to me, he says to me, Rabbi Amnon Yitzchak got us very angry. Why? He burned the New Testament in one of these lectures. They took one Jew, became a Christian, and then he realized they fooled him. It's all full of nonsense, as you can see in the debate. And then he decided to finally become a kosher Jew. So as a part of the ceremony of him making tshuva, they took all his belongings, everything. And they made all one big fire of all the idol-related items that he had. And they went crazy, you know. And when they saw it, so he sent me a threatening letter. So the letter was, I read it quickly because my day is very, very tight. I'm trying to do as much as I can. I give all every second. And I just, my friend came with me in a car. Every second, a new email, new text, new email, new phone call. Every second, mamash. So now, what am I going to do? I'm trying to just briefly look at everything quickly. So since I read it very quick, I didn't really realize what he meant in the email. He said, we are going to burn the Torah. Because of what he did, we're going to burn the Torah. So I wrote to him, how long are you going to waste time on this nonsense called Christianity? Didn't you open your eyes and realize that it's all baloney, it's full of errors, there's, you know, and I give him the whole thing. And then I say to him, the fact that you are threatening to burn the Torah, even though as Christianity accepted the Torah as a divine book from God and nobody ever denied this is the foundation of Christianity, show that you're all fake. Because what kind of Christian will dare to burn the book that he admits is the book of God? Show you, you're full of baloney. You don't have anything. No fear from God, no holiness, no nothing. So then he responded to me, you despicable Jewish immigrant. I didn't mean that we're going to burn the Holy Torah. I meant we're going to burn all of you Jews, wherever you are. 2,000 years you annoying and bothering Christianity, and it's a big thing to burn all of you, and you know, all kinds of things like this. He writes to me. So quickly I say, let me get this idiot away from my schedule. So I wrote to him, I'm on my way to report you to the police. Now remember, I don't know where he is. I'm going to report you to the police as you're making murder threats. By the way, they'll arrest him. You should see how he reacted 10 minutes later. Dear Rabbi Mizrachi, let's start fresh. Should see, send me maybe 10 emails since then already of apology. Let's start fresh. I myself a Jew. I live here in Israel. I never meant by any way that we're going to kill Jews. I know it's not the proper way. Sorry for my harsh language. Ta 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 ta. Let's get friendly. Here's my cell number. Now I see an area code of Israel, cell number, which means he lives in Israel, which makes my job easier. One phone call and he's going to be in jail for Shabbat. You know? But the Torah said, don't take revenge. It's better to make him realize his mistake. Because he's probably a missionary. What do you think they live in Israel, all these missionaries? They're hunting innocent Jews who have no idea what Judaism is, no idea about religion, and they get them into their cults, taking advantage on the ignorance. But once these Jews, you speak to them in their language, right away they'll see the mistake. The problem is there's not enough people who are anti missionary activist. Baruch Hashem, now with Hashem's help, finally after 3 years since we made that debate, we translated it to Hebrew. So now it's going to be in Israel, all over the internet, the media. Hopefully the Jews will not be fooled ever again after they see they have really nothing to offer. So remember, once according to Torah, once we go according to the Torah, Muslims, they have permission to live in Israel. Why? They scream one God. They want to follow the religion, even though it's a false religion. But at least it's not an idol worshiping, even though I have a person who fight with me in the last 2 weeks on emails that Muslims are idol worshippers, and he gave me an example that they also have different gods. You know, eventually it became Allah, but they have also different gods they believe in. I don't know, I have to look into it. Everything I say is based on the words of the Rambam. The Rambam said that if a Jew prayed inside a mosque, it wasn't a sin. But if he prays inside a church, it's a very big sin. Same thing in our day, Reform or conservative shuls, which they modify the truth of God. They change the truth of the Torah. And they say, this is the way the religion should be. That means it's becoming a different religion. Different religion, different idol. That's not our God. Our God didn't give this nonsense. He doesn't allow to marry men to men or Jews to any other Gentiles. Even if they're very nice Gentiles, there's no permission. So there's no permission to leave any of them in the Holy Land or any idol worshiper, like Buddhism. It's also idol worshiping. Hare Krishna, same thing they have in Israel. Now, what's the name of this new cult? Scientology. Also, now today in Israel, not only they not evict them from the Holy Land, they give them all kinds of buildings from the budget of the city. You know, because the people that runs Israel are very, very wicked people. Most of them, not all of them, but most of them are very wicked. They go against the Torah, they mechalel Shabbat, they steal, they cheat, they receive bribe, they do all kinds of things. And when a very, very rich cult or religion come and they want a building in the middle of Tel Aviv and they're offering the mayor $1 million under the table, what do you think he's going to do if he doesn't believe in Hashem? He doesn't care about religion. As a matter of fact, he hates religious people because they're looking at the religion as a threat to our freedom. They want to be free to do whatever they want. To rape, to murder, to celebrate, alcohol, drugs, whatever they like to do. So when someone come and scream the truth in their face, is annoying them. They cannot live with someone who tells me the truth every day. I'm tired of listening to him, right? So here, like my friend told me, in some shul in Brooklyn, he heard that somebody say, don't bring Rabbi Mizrachi. We cannot hear to his negative comments. We don't want to hear this. Why? Because I was there in that place and I told them that Mechalel Shabbat is 100% like a goy. Now what, instead of coming and say, well, I'm very sorry that I'm a sinner and this is what God thinks about me, instead of coming with this approach, hopefully I'll have the strength to change, so they get annoyed that the Torah tells them the truth. So it doesn't matter, it's this rabbi, that rabbi, but the rabbis who say the truth, not everywhere they are welcome. Why? Because who likes someone to tell him what kind of loser he is in his face every week? I cannot handle the truth. I'm talking according to the Torah. Maybe in business they're very successful. Maybe in other things, in sport, I don't know what. But in Torah, it's 100% a loser. And someone come and tell it to him in his face, you're nothing, you're zero, you have nothing, you don't know, you don't follow the way of Hashem, you live in a lie. Every second of your life is all one big illusion. It annoys them. It bothers them very much. So they don't want you to come and remind them a month later that they still have not changed. You understand what's going on here? This is what's going on. So, okay, mitzvah number 95. We have an obligation to build a house for Hashem. We have an obligation to build a house of Hashem. And the reason that we need to build a house for Hashem mainly is for all the sacrifices. As remember last week, I said the sacrifices are big, big, big secrets. In our generation, we don't even know 1% of all the secrets of all the different sacrifices, because there's many, many different sacrifices. Sacrifice when you made a sin intentionally. Sacrifice when you make a sin not intentionally. Sacrifice when it's a holiday. Sacrifice on Shabbat. Sacrifice on Yom Kippur. Sacrifice and someone who made a vow, and someone who became impure, and all kinds of different causes. Today, when we don't have the Holy Temple, what comes instead of the sacrifices? The prayers. Because we have a verse in the Torah, Uneshalma parim sfatenu. We are going to pay the sacrifices with our lips. Since we cannot sacrifice, there's no altar, there's no mizbeach, no bet hamikdash, comes the prayers and replace them. But if Mashiach comes and we build the third bet hamikdash, then we are going to be back as it was 2,000 years ago in the second temple that was destroyed. So we have an obligation. Now, once we have a temple in Jerusalem, then the distance between Hashem and us, the spiritual distance, become almost nothing. Right? The way we are very close back to Hashem, just like in Yom Kippur in Tfilat Ne'ilah. One day a year, Yom Kippur, we are very close to Hashem. Hashem said, Dirshu Hashem biyoto karov, biyimatzo. Request for me when I'm very close to you. When is the days of Tshuva, Seret Yemei Tshuva, and then Yom Kippur, Rosh Hashanah, etc. This is days that I'm very close to you. What do you mean? Hashem is everywhere. He's always close to me. He's here, he's here, he's here, he's everywhere. Every inch you're going to put your finger there, Hashem is there. There's no place in the world that you can put a box and say, inside the box, there's no Hashem. Let's do whatever we want inside. You can run to space. You can run to the moon. You can run to anywhere you want. Hashem is there. It's melo kol haaretz kvodo. The whole world is full with Hashem's spirit. So the idea is that when the temple is there, automatically days of glory coming back to the nation of Israel. And we are very close to Hashem. This is a mitzvah number 95. Of course, we can talk about it for a year. But we are doing just briefly the explanation to every mitzvah. And we go to mitzvah number 96. Once we have the Beit HaMikdash build, we have something that called the Badim. Badim, there's rings that is like a special stick, goes inside and they're picking up the Aron, they're picking it up with those two things. You know how like you want to pick up something, so two people stand in the front, they put it on their shoulders like this, and two in the back, and it goes into the rings. Now, all these things, the way to design the temple and all the things that we use inside, everything, it's all big secrets. Nothing is coincidence. It's not like a carpenter, he decides how we design the shul. Let's make it comfortable. Let's make it this size. Let's make it this height. Let's make it, 2 feet wide. This is all based on convenience. Over here, it's all big spiritual secrets. So for instance, the Torah says like this, "Betabaot Aaron yihu abadim lo yasuru mimeno." Those two sticks that we call them badim, there's no permission ever to take them out of the rings. No, anybody can give me a logical explanation. What's the problem? Let's say I pulled it out. I cleaned it, I pulled it up, and I put it back in. What happened? Tomorrow, we pick it up again, whatever. What really happened here? This is all big secrets of God that we will never know the secrets of them. Only when we go to the real world, when we understand everything over there, the Zohar say that once a person dies, he gets permission to see all the things that he could not understand when the soul was in a physical body. The physical body and the physical world are basically taking away all the ability of the soul to see things that he can see without the body. The body limited the soul. It's making the soul limited. Why? Because it's under the law of physics. But once the soul is out of there, right away, there's no distance. And when a person comes to the next world, everything is clear. Now we understand what tefillin really is, why it's like this, why it's not round, why there's four corners, why one shin is with four, one shin is with three, why it's black, why it's with this from this kind of animal. And now, so many millions and billions of things that right now we do just because we follow the instruction of Hashem, but we really, really don't have the deepness of it. We only know a little bit from the top. But we don't really go to the root of the things, because this is all amazing, brilliant things, which right away, you see right away that a person can never write such a thing. Everything will be clear. In the general religion, which means all the 613 commandments, but also in your personal life. Why this girl didn't want to marry you? You don't know. You went out 4 or 5 times, and then the last time the Shatchan say, well, something, I don't know what, she doesn't want to say. You don't know. You come to Shamayim, Hashem show you why not, and then he show you what would happen if you marry her. Everything, all your life, how it would be. Oh, beautiful YouTube movie in Shamayim. Wow, I would be this, I would be that. Sometimes you'll be very happy to see this movie. Sometimes you will rip your hair off when you compare who you really married in the end. Then you say, wow, what a mistake. If I only wouldn't do that sin that caused me to lose this girl, look what would happen. Bottom line, just for us to understand one thing, the biggest punishment in the afterlife, besides the shame and all the other physical punishments, is that they show you in Shamayim what you should have been with your potential. That's the biggest suffering that a person see. He think, I'm an important rabbi, I'm an important person, I do this, I do that, I'm involved with this, and he think, wow, and then he comes to Shamayim, and they say, you did not even fulfill 1% from your potential that I gave you. You know, you did this and this and that. Yeah, you taught a little Torah, you did this. But let's see if you would really be serious, what would have been? And then you see and you say, wow, I messed up the whole world. Everything was in my hand, in my palm. And I blew it. What? Laziness, stupidity, not being serious, no devotion, you're not consistent, etc., etc. There's many. You didn't correct your personality, honesty, integrity. There could be many reasons. Over there, everything will be clear. So one of these, so this mitzvah number 96, it's a mitzvah that with all the other mitzvot that stays for a generation. It's not a one time, one generation, or in one temple, in the second temple, and also in the third temple, we're still going to have this mitzvah. Not to take those badim out of the rings. Shelo yipasek ledorot miYisrael, will never stop for generation in the nation of Israel. At any time. Like some mitzvot was given only to the generation of the desert. What? Go and pick up the man every day, and Shabbat don't go. You go on Shabbat, you make a sin. Shem said, tomorrow Shabbat, no bread folly. You don't go. People went, they made it. Today, if you went to you live by the desert, and you want to take a walk in the desert and look for man on the floor, you're just a fool. You're not a sinner. Yeah, unless if it's michutz latchum. But I'm talking, you live right by the Judah, desert. And you walk out of your home, and you know, you can walk at 5 minutes, and you're in the middle of the desert already. And you walk, Moshe, what are you doing? I'm looking for man to see if really there's no man on Shabbat. He didn't make a scene. He just maybe need a mental institution. But this mitzvah, this sin was only in the time of the generation that used to receive man. Okay, mitzvah number 97 is, once we already have Bet HaMikdash, we have to make sure there is bread, what we call Lechem HaPanim, always on the table. There's a special table, tiny table, like the size of this tender. And over there is always bread. This bread stays for the whole week, and then they replace it, and it stays fresh. That's one of the miracles in Bet HaMikdash. It's always fresh, like these Bukharian breads who come out of the oven. As long as it's warm and fresh, it's the most delicious bread in the world. But once they already bring it to the bris tomorrow morning, and they put it on the table, you can break someone's head with that. It becomes so hard, you cannot even rip it apart. It's so thick and hard, but when you heat it up, wow, it's such an amazing bread. But that bread in Bet HaMikdash had this secret. No matter what, even 3, 4, 5 days after, it's always fresh and amazing. And the reason that like I said, whenever we say a reason, remember, we know one reason, there is another million that we don't know. Just for us to understand. One of the reasons is to show us that we have a verse in the Torah that a person has to know ki lo al lechem levado yichye adam. I have to remind you, you think that if you have bread, you're going to live. And if you don't have bread, you're going to die, which means food. Bread, it's the foundation of food. So I want to teach you, yes, you need bread to live. Without bread, you really die. But the most important thing is that what keeps you alive is the Torah, not the bread. The bread, it's nature, fine. But without Torah, you are not considered alive. Right? שנאמר, כי לא על הלחם לבדו יחיה האדם, not only with bread a person would live, כי אם על כל מוצא פי השם יחיה האדם. The person would live thanks to what came out of God's mouth. What? The Torah, the Ten Commandments. If you follow the Torah, you are alive. I have a whole lecture about this, just about this verse, and I called it, it's in the MP3, and it's audio. It's called Preparation for Eternal Life. What's the purpose of that lecture? To show, to prove scientifically, without any doubt, that every time that the Torah refers to the word life, you should live, you are alive, your children would live, etc., etc., is speaking about spiritual life, not physical life. Because really, there is no life in this world. Which means nobody is alive in this world. Now you may tell me, what do you mean? I'm alive, I'm walking, I'm doing things. Yeah, I speak. What do you mean I'm not alive? So what, I'm dead? Here, he's dead, he cannot talk. I'm alive, I can walk and talk. Once you are born, you are beginning a process. You are dying, like a battery. Yes, 100%. An hour later, 98, 94, 95. On a computer, they tell you 6 hours, but you die after 6 minutes. You know, it's all a trick to show you there is extended battery. But the battery of Hashem, there is no indication how long it's going to last for. No warning light, no beeps. You think your battery is full. Up an hour later, you finished. So really, from the minute you are born, you begin to die. When the battery will expire, when your supposedly term here in this world will end, you don't know. Why you don't know? Because if everyone would know when it turns on the computer, when is it going to die exactly, there's no rush. We have another 5 hours. If I'm here and I know, my time would go over 100 years in this world. So what's the rush? Why should I be righteous now? We have great things. I have 100 years to be here. Plus, I can do tshuva at age 99. A year before I leave, believe me, I give all my money to donation. I'm going to make 5 million CDs. I'm going to gather shoe. I'm going to put commercials on the television. Hey, divine information, Torah and science, come, seminars, hotel, I pay everything. I'll do this. I'll make tshuva, put 5 times an hour tefillin. I pray, I learn Torah all day. I watch my eyes. I lock myself in a place that's, well, you know, 100 years old. You don't need to watch your eyes. You don't see anyway, so anyway, I'm going to make such a good tshuva a year before I die, and everybody will die righteous. So why do I need to be 100 years old? So the idea is, when you don't know where you're living, you have to live with, like a gun is pointed to your head, like Russian roulette. Oh, maybe now it shoots. Oh, maybe tomorrow. You don't know. Since you don't know, you see, that's my last minute in life. It makes you do the right thing. So, this bread is a memory for us. Also, Hashem said, "Aviu lefanai Omer bePesach, kedei sheitbarchu lachem tvuot shebasadot." Bring next to me the sacrifice of the Omer in Pesach. What do we do? We begin to count the 50 days of the Omer, 49 days, and 50 days is Shavuot. These days of counting the Omer, they used to bring a special things that they cut, wheats that they cut with special tool. It's called magal. They used to cut it even on Shabbat. It's very strange because in Shabbat, cutting one wheat is like lighting fire. Not wheat. You go in your backyard and you pull up one grass, you rip it. You didn't pull it from the root. You just rip it already, it's already a sin. Just cutting. Pick up an orange from the tree, it's a sin. breaking a branch from a tree, it's a sin. All the things that you cut them from where they suck their energy from, right? You're not allowed to cut it. That's why nails, they receive their energy from the body. Once cutting them on Shabbat, you disconnected a part of your body from his life. So all these things, air, that's why it's a very big sin to be a barber on Shabbat. And I know a lot of your friends and cousins are barber and they stand all day 10 hours on Shabbat and cut hair. Every hair they cut, it's a sin from the Torah, just like lighting fire on Shabbat. Every sin that they do, it's big, big sin. All Shabbat they're cutting more and more and more in the machine, and then again, again, again. It's like millions of sins every Shabbat. And they get $100, which in the end they will never enjoy from it. And they prepare themselves a very, very deep place somewhere that I don't even want to tell you where. What? I'm a barber. Rabbi, there's nothing else I know how to do. That's how I make my living. And Shabbat, most of the customers come. I get a lot of tips. So $20 is going to make tips and then lose his eternity for it. You understand what's happened when you don't use your head? Either that you're ignorant, you don't know anything about life, about the Torah, about Shabbat. No, ignorance is the biggest enemy of a person. If you're an ignorant person, you live in the dark. But sometimes they even know that it's not allowed. But they're not imagining every dollar I get in a barber shop for Shabbat would cost me trillions. Every dollar will cost me trillions. And there's no lawyers to get you out with a deal over there. You understand? The Zohar said just as soon as the soul comes out, the person sees the Satan. Just when he sees the Satan, he realizes where he's going. That's it. The baloney, the nonsense, is all over in 1 second. You don't need anybody to explain to you to what world you're going to. Imagine seeing an angel that is full of millions of eyes. All you see is eyes. And a sword with the arm, and he comes to pick the soul out with a special sword. Just when a person sees the Satan, forget it. He understands, oh, the picnic is over. My secretary will not serve me coffee anymore. Good morning, Mr. Cohen. What's on the agenda today? Wire $2 million to this customer. Make me an appointment. Tell the captain to prepare my private jet. This is over, my friend. What about the jet ski? Did it arrive, the two that I ordered yesterday? We want to go on vacation next week. This picnic is over, my friend. Now it's time to pay for all your sins. One by one. 1, 2, 5, 10, 20, 20 million, 50 million, 30 billion. Depend how many you have. A barber in one Shabbat, every Shabbat he works is millions of sins for $100. Millions of sins for $100. What a great investment. In America, they say penny wise, dollar foolish. Investing a dollar to make a penny. What are we going to say about these people? Investing billions to make a dollar? It's not even a word for it. So this is it. So mitzvah number 98. It's to fix the candles in Beit HaMikdash. There's a menorah. The Kohen always clean it and put the candles. Similar to what we do in Hanukkah every day, fixing and putting the oil inside. The Torah say, Ya'aroch oto Aharon ubanav. Who does it? The Kohen and his children, which means all the Kohanim. Right? Klomar, he makes it, he said it in front of Hashem. It's called mitzvat hatavat hanerot. Why? Because the dirt that you have from yesterday, you clean inside, you put new oil, you put everything, you set it up. Every day is mitzvah. We have the Western candle that is lighting constantly from night to night, from evening to evening. But all the other candles, after a few hours, they go off. But that's one of the miracles of Beit HaMikdash, when people were seeing all, every day, Hanukkah miracle. Every day. You have in the other six, few hours, it's over. One of them going until the same amount of oil. Every day, Hanukkah miracle in Beit HaMikdash. Every day. So this is this mitzvah in the menorah in the Holy Temple. Mitzvah number 99. That there's a special alfet for the Kohanim, things that they wear before they go to serve inside the Holy Temple. They have an obligation to wear special clothes, as the Torah says, "Ve'asu bigdei kodesh le'aron." It's holy clothing, holy. Le'aron u'levanav. What's the root of this mitzvah? When a person changes clothes to special clothes, he, from now on, pay much more attention to his actions. I give you an example. A person that dress all week, ripped jeans, Crocs, baseball hat, much like a complete hippie. If he goes to work with this kind of clothes, let's say he wants to be a salesman, so he needs to come to sell, he's representing Microsoft. When he wears these things that he wears in a park or on the beach or in a pool, can he do his job properly the way he is? There's no atmosphere of work. But once he gets rid of it and he put his nice suit and tie and his nice leather case and his laptop, whatever, and he goes to the meeting, he's presentable. Changing your everyday way that you get dressed to special things, making you understand, now I'm on a job. Same thing a policeman. Why does he need a uniform? He can put a badge and finish. Put a uniform. Why? Now when I put my uniform, that's it, I'm on duty. I gotta look around, I have to pay attention, I have to be ready. And I remember that I gave a whole lecture two weeks ago about the autistic kids. So first time when I went to see this autistic kid in Brooklyn, many years ago, I brought one of my friends here from Queens. He lives here in Queens. He was already a Baal Tshuva, but he's embarrassed to dress like a Jew. He doesn't walk with a yarmulke. He goes with a baseball hat. You know, you have in Brooklyn people that are religious all their life. Their parents and grandparents and grand-grand-grandparents all the way to Moshe Rabbeinu were all religious. When they go to their office, it's tradition by them. They don't put the yarmulke. They all have this light yarmulke in their pocket. When they sit in a restaurant, they take it out. They make Birkat Hamazon, they take it off. Now looking at him, he looks like a goy. But believe me, he keeps almost all the mitzvot, this guy. He goes to Daf Yomi, he learns, he put filin, he goes to Minyan 3 times a day, but he doesn't go with the yarmulke. But embarrassed to be a Jew. I brought this guy, at least this guy put a baseball hat. He covered his head at least. He doesn't walk without covering his head. So he came to the room and the autistic kid started to attack him, a massive attack. Now remember when I took him to Borough Park, this autistic kid was a son of a very important rabbi that writes books, big Talmid Chacham. The house is full of books. As soon as we walked in, I made my friend dress like a Hasid from Bnei Brak. Black suit, white shirt, black yarmulke. He looks 100% religious, no doubt. As soon as he walked through the door, he started to attack him on his clothing. So my friend told him, "Why do you care about the outside? You should worry about the inside. Why do you care how I dress? Talk to me about my sins, about things that I do. Why, you care how I dress?" So he told him, "You dress like a goy, and because you dress like this, it's affecting your inside. Because the outside affecting the inside. Your clothing affecting your behaving. That's it, 100%. You dress special, you begin to behave different." Now, I'm not talking show off. Don't get the wrong impression here. You don't need a $10,000 suit or even a $1,000 suit. It is respectable clothing. Oh, I have my uniform. A Jew always have to dress nice. Doesn't matter, winter, summer, during the day, doesn't matter. He has special clothes for Shabbat, yeah, the nicest clothes. But during the week, always nice jacket, nice shirts, if he can go with a tie, why? Remember, we are not just ordinary people in this world. We are the representative of the boss of the world. We are the children. Our father is the king of the world. A prince cannot walk with Crocs and shorts in the middle of Main Street when his father is the king of the world. Not the king of the United States. The king of all the worlds is your father. You're not embarrassed to walk like this on the street and sometimes to come to the synagogue to pray like this with your mechanic and the grease on your hand? Cannot change your clothes for the prayers. Where I pray, there are people who are working in dirty jobs. Mechanics, this, electrician. But they have a special outfit in a shul. As soon as they come, quickly they wash themselves, they change the clothes, they pray, they take it back. Sometimes they go back to work in a winter time. 4 o'clock they pray. They put their clothes, they take it off, they put back the blue, dirty outfit, and they go back to the garage to work. Other people walk in like this with all the dirt, standing in front of Hashem. Would you go to the meeting with Obama with your grease, the grease on your outfit? Obama gave you an appointment, 5 minutes of his time. So Obama would tell you, why you came with this kind of clothes to meet with me? You tell him, well, you know, you made me the appointment at 4 o'clock. It's in the middle of my working day. Would you expect me to go change just for the appointment? Would you get from Obama anything that you needed? Huh? You won't get anything. Why? It's disrespect. So the outfit of the Kohanim is all special. Now remember, the regular Kohen has clothing. The Kohen Gadol has extra 4 pieces of clothing that the ordinary Kohen Hediot, Hediot with Hey means ordinary, regular, doesn't have. Which means even when he's elevated to the highest level, there's only one Kohen Gadol, he's in charge of all of them, is the highest, he gets extra 4 pieces of clothing to tell the difference between a regular Kohen to this special Kohen who goes into Kodesh HaKodeshim in Yom Kippur. Mitzvah number 100, that one of the things that the Kohen wearing is a choshen. It's a board. He has a special board. It's hanging on his neck. And there are 12 precious stones. All kinds of precious rubies. I don't even know to say the names in English. Yeah, when you're shfeh, all kinds of things. Very expensive things, you know. And there are 12, one for each tribe. 12 tribes, 10 stones. You know, each tribe, there's a stone with the name of the tribe. Now, the choshen is in the front. There's something in the back called ephod. They always have to go together. This is 2 of the 8 pieces of clothing that the high Kohen is wearing. 2 of the 8. They always have to be together. We're not allowed to remove the choshen from the ephod. Comes the ephod and the choshen, all is one unit. There's no permission to separate between them. What's the reason? We don't know. Only Hashem knows. Hashem. Ki lo machshevotai machshevotechem. My thoughts and your thoughts are not the same. Don't try to understand my deepness. You can understand a little bit. What I allow you to understand, you can understand. You don't understand all the secrets of the worlds and the spiritual worlds. Which means if a person does it, it makes a very serious problem in a spiritual world. It's like you don't see the reaction of it right now. But by making a specific sins that the Torah said, be careful, don't do that, you are damaging the higher spiritual world in a way that you're not even aware of what you're doing. This is the Sifrei Musar, all the Chachamim, they write in the Sifrei Musar that a Jew, even with his thoughts, is defecting and damaging the upper worlds. With his thoughts, he didn't dare to say. He just had a dirty thought about a woman, about something, about I don't know what. Just a dirty thought already making a huge damage. Needless to say, when he speaks and does, which is already higher sin, just the thought that came a minute, it's already a bad problem. Then, mitzvah number 101, that we're not allowed to rip or to make holes in any way in the special me'il, the coat of the Kohen Gadol, the kilt that he wear, we call it a me'il. Even in Hebrew, in the modern Hebrew, me'il is a coat. You have a suit, khalifa, jacket, and then you have a me'il. This is the one we wear in the winter on top, the long one, me'il. Okay, really the right way to say it's me'il, im ayin. Ayin, it has to come from the throat. Some people, they don't separate. They say me'il with aleph, it's not correct. So it has to be me'il. And what is it? To have ripped clothes is disrespect. Person walk, if he doesn't have what to wear, better to wear something ripped than to be naked on the street, no? But if he has clothing, and he has holes, ripped, cuts, all kinds of things, and he doesn't care, that's disrespecting himself, disrespecting his family, disrespecting his community, disrespecting his nation, disrespecting his God. No matter how you look at that. Why? You are my representative. If a person from our community walks like this and people film him and they put him on television, it's an embarrassing for each one of us. When a religious person went with ripped clothes and the goyim thinking, look how these Jews dress. I suffer. He suffer. He suffer. Everyone suffer. Not suffer, but get affected. Tomorrow when I go on a meeting, they don't look at me in a nice way. Why? Because they saw someone who looks like me and he has holes in his clothing. Or the other way around. And he's extra elegant and clean always and not smelly or et cetera, et cetera. Then it gives good reputation to all of us. Same thing by the goyim. When one goy with a different color of skin make a crime, right away, all of them like this, all of them like this. When the other color does it, they all like this. When this kind of nationality does it, this is all terrorist. When the people like to generalize, this is the nature of the people, even though it's a big mistake, because it brings to a lot of really serious problem. When you generalize or you prejudge people because of where they came from, or the city, or their accent, or the color of the skin, or whatever it is, many times you make a very, very big mistake which affecting him and you. An innocent person is suffering because of your generalizing, and sometimes you are making the wrong decisions in your business, in your personal life, based on wrong information that you have. Why? Just because you heard a lot of rumors about this kind of people. And that's a very common mistake. So, mitzvah, so there is no permission to wear a ripped coat, and there is no permission, we're talking about the Kohen Gadol. Kohen Gadol is a special representative of God to make sure to check his coat that it doesn't have any holes in it, any ripped or anything like that. Then, mitzvah number 102, that the Kohanim has an obligation to eat meat a little bit from the sacrifices. Not the whole sacrifice, some of it, like when we bring Korban Chatat Ve'asham. Korban Chatat is if a person made a sin not intentional of Chilul Shabbat, Isurei Karet, he brings a Korban, some of it the Kohen eats. And also Korban Asham. And the Torah says, "Ve'achlu otam asher kupar ba'em." A part of the repentance that the Jew is making is feeding this Kohanim. That's their parnasa. They eat. So Kohen, you should know, Kohanim, they needed to like meat because all day you eat shish kebab. All day you eat all roasted meat. You know, all this lamb. Sheep, all these things, that's what they eat all day, for every sacrifice, even though it shifts, different Kohanim. But still, they also had a doctor who was checking their health, because when you eat so much of it, and it has a lot of fatty meat, it's not good for the health. But we should know that I saw a very interesting interview with an experienced Israeli doctor. And speaking about cholesterol in the meat. And he claims, we have to check a little bit deeper, but he claims that it's all nonsense. That it's never been proven that the fat in the meat or all this what we call the bad cholesterol brings anyone to die from it. And he says that to his patients, up to 240, 250 cholesterol, he doesn't even bother to tell them. Which today some doctors make a big deal out of it. So the host and a radio, someone sent me an email, it's 5 minutes from an interview. So the host asked him, what are you saying? The whole world knows, doctors, when they go to school, that high cholesterol, it's a life risk. He said, it's all nonsense. The whole world of medicine is all corrupted and all lies. All the doctors are a part of this scam and they're not even aware of it. It's all run by the drug companies. They own the world. They own the politicians, they own the president of the United States, they own everything. They decide how many trillions they are going to make, and they make up all kinds of viruses and all kinds of sickness, and then they create medicine for it, and they make fortunes of trillions of dollars. They run the world, they own everything. And a part of it, they have these tricks of constantly scaring the people and creating the need for new medication, and this is also cholesterol. So nobody ever proven a direct connection between bad cholesterol to death or any kinds of thing. Very strange. Now he speaks on the radio, and he's more than 20 years a big doctor in Israel, and the Israeli doctors, compared to the rest of the world, they have very high reputation. Many of them are the biggest in the world here in America, in New York. They come here for the big money. And in almost in every respectable hospital, you see that the top doctors there are from Israel, which means he's not supposed to be a fool in medicine. That's what I'm trying to say. I'm not saying that he's right or wrong. We have to keep be carefully to check it. But I'm saying that if he's standing there in front of the whole nation and speaking on prime time on the radio, and without even hesitation, completely put an X on it, without even one doubt, so 100% I'm right. It's nothing. It's nothing. Being heavy in general is not good for the health. It creates other problem. Person has to be healthy. But to come, some people have very high cholesterol and they never die. They live very long life. And some people that are very skinny, no, and all of a sudden can get a heart attack. Where this heart attack came from? Without cholesterol, without fat, without... There's different reasons for it. But that's besides the point. But this Kohanim is to eat a lot of meat. As a part of it, eating meat all the time, you need the following of a doctor to check how you're doing. So mitzvah number 103, the Kohanim has to do what we call Ktoret Asamim. Every day in Tfilat Shachrit, before we pray, we say the Pitum Ktoret. And then in Mincha, the Sfaradim at least, they say also, some Ashkenazim, when they pray early, they also say it. It's called Pitum Ktoret. There's 11 spices that are mixed into something that supposedly is the best smell a person can ever smell. When you smell it, it's like taking the soul out of the body, the smell of this. 10 of the spices are amazing spices that give beautiful and great smell. One of them give very bad smell. One of it's called Levona. In that case, when the special smell, it's only when all 11 are together. Each one by one, yeah, cinnamon, for instance. When you heat cinnamon, you burn cinnamon, you have a special smell. But to say it's the best smell in the world, eh. But when all of them combine, it gives an amazing smell. Now, it also has a very big secret. What's the secret? When you heat it, when you burn it, you have all this smoke comes out. And this can cure a nation for an epidemic. When the Torah said, when Moshe went up to heaven, his body was on Mount Sinai, but he so went up to the upper worlds. The angel had a big battle against Moshe not to let him take the Torah to earth. They were arguing, mamash like in a court, objection, Hashem, why you want to give a Torah to a person made from a woman, came out from a woman womb? Isn't it a shame for your great Torah that you want to give it to people like this? They go to the bathroom, they sit in the bathroom, they lie, they cheat, they steal, they kill. Why you want to give them a Torah, this precious gift of yours? You want to give it to these lowlifes? That's what the point of the angels. And Moshe was arguing with them. He said the whole purpose of the Torah was to take these lowlifes and make them high lives, make them better. You know, stop stealing, stop cheating, stop. This is what do you have? You steal? You have parents? You have to learn how to respect your parents? Why do you need the Torah? So then in the end, when Moshe won the argument, every angel had to give him a gift. Angel of medicine gave him this. This angel of... Everyone gave him something. And the angel of death, what did he give him? He gave him the secret of Pitum Ktoret, of this Ktoret, that when people are dying, 1,000, 2,000, 5,000 people, every minute, someone, an epidemic, people are falling and dying. So the epidemic goes from one city to another, right? It goes from this side, and then more people catch it, more and more and more. Now it's coming to our direction. So the angel of death told him, when something like this happens, you go, you make a line. You go from one side to the other side with this Pitum Ktoret, and the epidemic will never cross the line you made. With this Pitum Ktoret. And that's Moshe used it. In Magefa, that was in the Torah, it described that in the Gemara say, how did Moshe know that that's the way to prevent the death? And the answer is the angel of death was forced to tell him, because the angel of death is an expert in life and death. He takes the souls of people out. So he told him that secret, how to stop the epidemic. So this pitum aktoret. Why do you have to put a bad spice? You have 10 great spices. Why do you put one horrible spice, horrible smell? Why? Make it 11 good spices. 10 and one good one. Why one bad? The answer is, when 10 people wants to pray to Hashem, or even 1,000 people wants to pray to Hashem, the requirements are that at least in the place when everyone gather to pray, there are 10 kosher people. Everyone else is extra, no problem. You want the prayer to be a kosher prayer and a legitimate prayer and to be brought to Hashem express, make sure you have 10 Shomrei Shabbos people in the minyan. Everybody else that come and they're not Shomer Shabbat, they can be as 11, 12, and 13, etc. If you don't have 10 kosher people, you're not allowed to pray. You're not allowed to say Kaddish, you're not allowed to take out the Torah, you're not allowed to say Kedusha, not allowed to say anything in a shul. You tell them, I'm sorry, I know there's 1,000 people came here, but there's not 10 people who Shomer Shabbat here. Almost everyone came with a car. So I'm unable to perform a ceremony. Why? If people would say now it Gadal Vit Kaddash, it could be a Mechalel Shabbat. There's no permission to say Amen on his bracha. It's big problems here. And it's all from Shulchan Aruch. You don't have to believe me. In 7 different places in Shulchan Aruch, the book of Jewish law, it says that Mechalel Shabbat is 100% like a goy and cannot participate in any Jewish ceremony, any whatsoever, until he makes tshuva. Once he makes tshuva, he's accepted back to the nation of God. As long as he did not stop violating Shabbat, he's on a ban. We are here and you are there. You're in isolation. Your isolation, it's up to you. It's your free choice. It's not like the goy. The goy is in isolation all his life. He didn't sin, but he's not the son of God. Yesterday, last night, I made a lecture. The difference between Jews and the non-Jews. Not physically. Physically, there's no difference. Why from 7 billion people, Hashem care about the 13 million people so much? Why Hashem decided that only a small group of people from this whole world will be special and everybody else will be ordinary, nothing special? Why is it? Is it discrimination? Is it racism? What is the reason? Well, imagine a father has 11, 15 kids, and now he decides, you I like, you're special for me, you be with me in a business, you will inherit everything from me, you are the most important for me, and all of them, I can care less what they do. They do, they keep, I give them a little money, end of story. What's going on here? It doesn't sound good. We have to be honest. But when you hear this lecture, at least you understand how it started. Just in case you're thinking it's not justice, I promise you it's 100% justice there. And remember the rule, everybody get what he deserves. We got thousands of punishments, Holocaust, pogroms. We pay for it. What do you think? You just got a gift and that's it? For this gift that we got, we are the most tortured nation in history. How many billions of people died just because of that gift that we got? If you add all the children should have come out of it. Every gift has also responsibility with that. If your father come and say to you, yeah, you're going to run my business, you're working 16 hours a day, you're not getting anything for free, my friend. You're going to have to work very hard. You know what does it mean, 613 things to keep? The other kid, he comes to the business 10 minutes a day, he gives the mail a little bit, and then he goes back to the beach. You don't work, you don't get. But the question is, now a goy wants to be Shomer Shabbat. Would it help him to make him a Jew? No. It's not even permitted to do it. But a non-Shomer Shabbos Jew, all he has to do is to decide, enough with my nonsense. That's it. From this Shabbat, I'm beginning to keep. He doesn't need conversion. He doesn't need anything. All he has to do is to change. That's the difference between a person who takes a decision to change and another person who takes a decision for change. For one, he's going to help. For the other, he won't. It won't help Ahmed. He can keep Shabbat as much as he wants. He'll die as a goy. But a Jew, in 1 minute, can go back to be a Jew. Because he's originally a Jew, but he's on a ban now. He lost his card, his membership, his identity. He lost it. Oh, well, I have a membership. I'm a member here. No, no, my friend. You put on a blacklist. You cannot enter the gym. What do you mean? I have a membership. checking a computer. Yeah, yeah, we know you. We know where you, you know, you belong to this gym. But right now you cannot come in. Why? You're picking at the girls over there. It's against the law here. You're doing all kinds of bad things in the gym. Go and become a human being and then come back and we reinstate your membership. You're violating the law of the boss of the club. He told you not to be a violator of Shabbat. You violate it in public and you have the nerve to come and you want to come into his gym? He owns the world, no? How do you want to be a part of his nation when you rebel against him every week? How? You understand? But the other one, he wasn't even a member. And he shouldn't feel bad. I wasn't a member. I don't owe you anything. You don't owe me anything. I have my own things that I have to do. Mitzvah number 104. When we sacrifice the animals, we have to make sure never. And when we, there's, you know, in the Beit HaMikdash, you have few altars, not one. One of them is called Mizbeach HaZahav. This Mizbeach HaZahav is inside the Echal. That's a very small altar. There's one outside which is bigger than this shul almost. 16 meter by 16 meter and very tall, and you have a ramp to go. It looks like a big, almost a baseball field. Very big. And they make special stages inside. They don't use the whole thing. They're standing, when you stand with your feet on the altar while you sacrifice the animals. But the little one, the gold one, is very small, very, very small. And it says it's inside the Echal. And when we sacrifice, שלא להקריב במזבח הזהב שבהיכל כי אם כתורת שבכל יום. What are we using this for? The ketoret that we just spoke about, these 11 ingredients. We do it on this special, except הזעת הדמים מיום הכיפורים ליום הכיפורים. Except the different things that we splash the blood from one Yom Kippur to the other Yom Kippur. The Torah says, לא תעלו עליו כתורת זרה ועולה ומנחה ונסך לא תסקו עליו. Like I said, most of the mitzvot in the Torah are somehow directly or indirectly related to the holy temple. And today when we don't have the temple, more than half of the mitzvot does not apply. We don't have all these things. For us, sometimes it sounds like Chinese. You can learn Torah all your life, but you don't have it realistically. But people who saw it, you see it in Beit HaMikdash. Everyone knows, every kid lives into this reality. 2,000 years after it was destroyed, you take anyone from yeshiva, do you think he knows, he has a clear picture how these things used to be? I heard that in the time of Chafetz Chaim, they have a special yeshiva just for this kind of learnings. Because they knew that the rest of the learner, the scholars, they're very weak when it comes to knowledge about Beit HaMikdash. And so much to know. It's like a whole separate religion by itself. So they used to learn only these things to become special in it, that when Mashiach come, everyone will be prepared for it. What is it like? If you want to be a brain surgeon, do you think that just by learning it in school or in college, you're going to be able to operate on someone's brain? You can be 50 years in Harvard University, the best medical school in the world. 50 years you learn from the books, you won't know how to operate. As a matter of fact, your friend will be 4 months in the operation room as an assistant to the doctor, giving him the scissors, the knife. And after 4 months that he worked with his doctor, and he never went to college, complete ignorant person, he doesn't even know how to spell English. Someone like this, God forbid if you have to choose someone who went to Harvard for 50 years and learned in medical school, but never operate on a brain, never. Or this guy who worked with the doctor for 4 months, he's not even a doctor, he doesn't have a degree, nothing. And God forbid, now you have to decide, you all three of you on the island. You, the little kid, four. And this guy and the one from medical school. And both of them wants to do the operation. Who would you put your son's brain, God forbid, lo aleinu, in which hands you're going to put? The guy who learned 50 years in school, or the guys who saw 4 months from morning to night how they do it? That's it. So if it's not real, you don't see from hand to hand, How do you know how to change brakes, mechanic? You can learn in a manual 500 years. When you come to do it, something will go wrong. Wait a minute, where the school goes? Where? But if you went and you walk 3 days, you see this Vini shows you. See this? Oh, that goes here. This is goes here. Vini taught you how to change brakes. You know how to change brakes? Same thing here. Since it's all practical mitzvot, and there are certain things to do, if you're born into it, you just know it. Your father is doing it. You know it. In Israel, who do you think make all the cases of the tefillin? It's a secret. What do you think? Everyone can learn in a book and knows how to make tefillin? There's few families who control, like the Jewish mafia of the tefillin. Everybody, you can learn. Yeah, you can read all the instruction. No chance you can make tefillin. Only him and his two sons. And then one of the grandsons goes into the factory and they make it. And it goes, it's very complicated to make. From the minute it was a cow until it becomes this black case of tefillin, which is all pure leather, it takes a year. You know, it's so many steps. So many steps. One of them you did wrong, it's not kosher. Not kosher. All right, now, time is running out. We have a few more minutes. So, mitzvah number 105. Every Jew from 20 years old and older, once he reached 20 years old, whether he's rich, whether he's poor, he must give machatzit a shekel, a coin. We have shekel, we have half a shekel. Like you have a dollar, imagine you have a coin that it's 50 cents, right? So it's half a dollar. This, they used to be very small. I actually held one of them in my hand from more than 2,000 years ago. It was found by the archaeologist. This coin of machatzit a shekel, I held three of them to do zecher. We do in Purim, Zecher l'machatzit ha-shekel, so we did it with the original one that is mentioned in the Torah. So, you know, so by the way, this week, a few days ago, they found the bells that the Kohanim used to have, an original complete bell the archaeologists found, gold bell. Gold bell could be from the first temple or the second temple. Either way, it's either 2,600 years old or 2,000 years old, or it can be even 3,000 years old, depend from what generation they found. Between 2,000 and 3,000 years old, complete bell. The original bell as is described in the Gemara. Okay, now, so everyone, once he reached 20 years old, the Torah, every time the Torah count people, the Torah only count people from age 20 to age 60. What about all the others? They don't count? Of course they count, but they don't count in accounting. Why? 20 to 60, that's already a perfect, ready human being. That's the good years of his life. When you're 20, you're fully mature. 60, you begin slowly to go down on your abilities. And also in a war, from what age you become a soldier, etc., etc. There are, of course, all the other, when you bar mitzvah, you're already a man. You can get married already. You can run a house, you can run a business. That's how it was. But 20 years old, that's what Hashem says in the Torah. So the Torah says, it doesn't matter you're rich or poor, everyone has to give this machatzit shekel. And they give it to the Kohanim in Bet HaMikdash, to the Kohen. And what did they do? They used to put everything in the lishkachat, in one room, one place, in the temple. And from there, they used to buy the tamid, the sacrifices of the tamid. Every morning, there is in the morning one sacrifice. It's called Korban HaTamid Shel HaBoker of the morning. That's why we pray Shachrit every day, because we cannot bring this sacrifice every morning. Instead of that, we have the morning service. And the afternoon, Korban HaTamid of the afternoon, Ben Arbaim, which means when it's getting dark. So that second Korban, those two Korbanot, it's for the entire nation of Israel. So we take it out of the bank account of the Bet HaMikdash. Yeah, they didn't have a bank account like today, but they had a safe. All these coins that people gave, from that they used to take out, they go, they buy. They have special people who work in Bet HaMikdash. Gabaim, people, they go, they buy it. And one, they sacrifice in the morning, and they use the money that everyone from Israel gave, which means every Jew has a stock in this company. Every Jew has a share in that sacrifice of the morning and in the evening. It's all connected to this mitzvah. Sometimes it's an individual sacrifice. I have to buy it. I made a sin. I'm obligated to lose the $300 to buy the sheep. But here it's like a holiday sacrifice. Everybody participate because it's for everyone. Tamid of the morning, of the evening, of Yom HaKippurim. Everybody. Everything that is used for everybody, they use this money from. So this is, okay, now what's the weight of it? It's called Mishkal Asara Gera Kesef. It's like a very, very tiny, not a lot. Very, it's not something. That's why even the poor people can afford it. We're not talking in millions here, right? And they put everything, as we said, and they use it for Korban HaTamid of the morning and of the evening. Also Musaf, Rosh Chodesh now. They have a special extra sacrifice. That's why in Rosh Chodesh we pray another prayer, Musaf. Why? Because there was another sacrifice. Shabbat, we have an extra prayer, Musaf. Because in Shabbat, they have an extra sacrifice. In Shabbat, in Bet HaMikdash, they sacrifice animal. If you sacrifice an animal today on Shabbat, every second it's a sin from the Torah. You slaughter him, one of the 39 restrictions. You take off his skin, another sin. You took out blood, another sin. Cut him to pieces, another sin. But in Bet HaMikdash, it's a different world. Bet HaMikdash was like an island in the middle of the land that has different laws in it. Different laws from the rest of the land. Things that everywhere else can be a sin, over there it's a big mitzvah. Or the other way around. Things that you do other way, you can make it over there. If you do it in Bet HaMikdash, you have no share to the world to come. So depend on it, depend on what you do, okay? Because it's like mamash, like a different territory and different laws apply to the Holy Temple. Then, mitzvah number 106, to wash the hands and the legs every time a person enters the Echal of Bet HaMikdash. He comes, every time the Kohen comes, before he goes, he has to wash his hands and the legs. Why the hands and the legs? Because we have the nails. Why the nails are so impure? When you cut nails, the Gemara say the best thing is to burn it and destroy it from the world. Right? Like if you bury it, one day it can come out. I don't know, someone digs, oh, it came out. If you just throw it, you consider wicked if you throw it. Why you jeopardize people? A pregnant woman walk over it, she can lose her baby. What's the problem with these nails? Why we have to do netilah on the hands? Why don't we have to wash our heads every morning? Huh? Why don't I have to wash my beautiful belly every morning? Why do I have to wash my hands? What's the big deal with the hands? The answer is because really, really, we have to wash the hands and the legs every day. That's really what it is. Why the impurity comes where the nails is. When a person goes to sleep, a part of his soul goes up to the upper world. And because he's more dead than before, which means a lot of his spirituality is gone, all the bad negative demons and spirits and all kinds of things attach to him. Where they attach? In a place that reminds them who Adam used to be. Adam, the perfect creation of Hashem, was all nail. There was no flesh, no skin like this. It was made all from nail. All his body was like a diamond. When the sun was reflecting on his body, it's an amazing scene. You couldn't see what a beautiful... Mama, the angels, the Chazal said, the angels, when they saw him for the first time, they thought this is God. They got confused. The ankle of Adam, also it was very big in his physical size. His ankle, his heel, was brighter than the sun. Just for us to understand who was the creation of Adam and look what we became. Tiny midget, all flesh, 70 years. Nothing. After the sin, we became what you see here. His gray hair. That's what we have today. But this is a memory of what we used to be. And that's what drives them crazy. Because remember, they are the opposite of holiness. We have people that are the opposite of holiness. Some of them sit in a Knesset. As soon as they see a religious person, they're allergic. They go crazy. If they sit in a radio, all these liberal Jews, and a religious guy wants to talk on the radio and bring his own comment to what happened, they'll never let him in. They'll go everything. Why? They all left. pro-Palestinian, pro-Arab. Just let the murderers come and speak on the radio in Israel. The rabbi wants to speak? No, absolutely not in our station. This is what's happening today. So these demons and all these negative things, they come to the nails. So why don't we wash the nails in the leg? Because it won't help. The impurity on the legs is so strong, no matter how much you wash it, it won't even help you anymore. That's why we're not allowed to touch the legs. If a person touches the legs right away, he has to wash the hands, because they became impure. When the Kohanim, before they enter Bet HaMikdash to work, they wash the legs and they wash the hands. And every time when they eat from the bread, they wash their hands. That's why all Jews in the world, before they eat bread, they wash their hands. Why? That when Mashiach comes and will build the third temple, that God forbid they won't forget that it used to be a very important mitzvah to wash their hands before you eat this bread, this holy bread. That's why we have to do Nitila. But I'm not a Kohen. My friend is a Kohen. Let him wash his hands every time he eats bread. Why I have to get in a plane and go to the bathroom and fill up a cup and wash my hands? I can eat bread without. I'm not a Kohen. No, my friend. If some of the Jews won't wash, the rest will copy from them. Because remember, the Kohen doesn't feel that he's special. What Kohen feel that he's special, that his last name is Kohen? I'm not talking the Kohanim that they are Goyim. There are many Kohanim in America that are not Jewish. Why? His mother is not Jewish. His father is a Jewish Kohen who married a Goya. So if his last name is Kohen, please do not be fooled by that today. But in the time of the Gemara, if your last name was Kohen, 99.9% you are real Kohen. You understand? So what happened is, if the Kohanim today will see that everyone eats bread without washing, what's going to happen to them? They're also going to stop. Few generations later, one day they build Bet HaMikdash, they come, they eat the bread, and they don't wash their hands. So to prevent such a thing, all Jews all over the world wash their hands as a mitzvah, as a halacha, for the day that we're going to need it, that God forbid the Kohanim won't do it without washing their hands, to show you how important is this wash. And as a result of that, what's our reward for washing our hands? Since we are not really obligated, then they're not Kohanim. Kohen is obligated. Okay, that's tradition in his family. He also has to do Birkat Kohanim. But I'm not. So what is my reward now for doing it 70 years? For him. First, it's really not for him. It's for the entire nation of Israel. But the reward is wealth. Mucho dinero. The more you wash, the more you're going to make. Don't worry. It's segula to become rich. Al netilat yadayim. When we say, Baruch Ata Hashem Elokeinu Melech HaOlam. אשר קדישה מצוותה, על נטילת ידיים, על נטילת ידיים, על עין, נטילת למד, ידיים יוד, אני. The opposite of someone who doesn't wash נטילת ידיים, אני, עין, נון, יוד, poor. You don't want to be poor, spill a lot of water, don't be stingy. Now remember, today it's very easy, you press a button, you have water. We are talking in the time of the Torah. You know how difficult it was to get water to the house? You have to walk a mile to the lake. You send your kids. They have a little pole with two big buckets. They fill it up, and they put one on this side and one on this side on their shoulder, and they come. Or you have to buy water. The Arabs have something on their head. They have a big barrel, you know, the women, the men, and all day they walk with this thing on their head, and you want to buy, hey, Mustafa, come. How much? You buy water. It saves you the time to walk to the well. So the rich people, they had Mustafa around their house all day. But the poor people, they themselves Mustafa, has to go and get water. And still, the Torah says, spill a lot of water, don't worry. Go again, bring from the well, bring from the lake. But it's gula for wealth. That was mitzvah number 106. And maybe the last one for today, mitzvah 107, to make a special oil. It's called Shemen HaMishcha. This oil is holy. When you want to make a regular Kohen, Kohen Gadol, the special Kohen, you spill it on his head. When you want to take a Jew and make him the king of Israel, you spill it on his head. That's when Samuel, the prophet, put it on the head of David HaMelech. From that moment, he became the king. How do you know officially when a person becomes a king? When they wrote about it in a newspaper, when he wins the election, when he moves into office, which means into his palace, or from the minute the oil touches his head. Why we care? I'll tell you why. Because sometimes Hashem sends the prophet to a house of someone and say his son, name such and such, is the new king. So he spill oil on his head, and officially now he's the king. But he's still a shepherd, standing in the mountain with his flute, playing some music to the sheep, cleaning their bathroom a little bit. Officially, he's the king of Israel now. Now, what happened if you're another shepherd in a field and you don't like him, so you curse him? Up to now, before the oil touches his head, you curse him. It's a sin from the Torah. A Jew cursed another Jew. Sin. Like eating pork. Now you must get killed. You cannot stay alive. Why? You insulted, you rebelled against the king of Israel. If he moves into the palace, now they put the crown on his head. He has a special carriage with horses, messenger. Everybody knows he's a king. But over there, nobody knows yet. So this big thing, once they put the oil on his head, that's it, he's the king. Now let's see you saying something to him. He can take his sword and chop your head off. Why is the king? He's above the court. You should know, if a thief got caught, we have no permission to kill him. If I'm the judge in a Jewish court, I'm sitting with two of my friends, with three judges, in a Beit Din, and somebody got caught. We have two witnesses that saw him stealing from someone's pocket money. We know he stole $100. What's the maximum penalty we can give him? Pay $200. The $100 you stole plus $100 penalty. What you wanted to do to your friend, we do to you. Now comes the king and says, I'm sorry, judges. I want to make a big declaration, a big statement. I want to take him to the middle of town and chop his head off. Lema'an yir'u ve'yirau. For every Jew to learn, I'm tired of thieves. That's it. No more stealing. You're not afraid of paying double? Let's teach you the hard way. We take him on. Everyone, you see, from now on, everyone who steals, that's what's going to happen to him. Whoop! Finished. Nobody steals anymore. That's the way people understand. Go on the highway. Everybody try to drive slow. Slow down, speeding, slow down, because they know where the police hiding. Say tomorrow on the news, the police went on strike. No highway patrol. You make it from Queens to Muncie in half an hour instead of an hour and a half. Why not? Highway, no cars, 2 o'clock at night, wide highway. 120 miles an hour in Muncie, in 25 minutes. Like in Germany, no speed limit. Whoop, 1, 2, 3, finished. Today, 50, drive 50, 55. Every corner they hide. It seems to me that this country is going bankrupt, but somehow they have a lot of money for more highway patrol. That's the reason, because they want more money. The whole system here is corrupted. They take highways that you can drive easily 75 without jeopardizing anyone, and they make it 50. They know nobody will drive 50 there. They know. And that's very good, Rabbi. Everyone will pay us. It's up to us. It's like going on a beach and collecting sand. The more you want to collect, the more you have. It's up to you. If the police wants, they collect an extra $1 million every minute. It's up to them. All they have to do is put more cars in the highway. And they catch more people, 300, 200. It's very good to make laws that will help us to steal the money from our citizen in a kosher way, according to the law. So what's this special oil? This special oil, it was given from generation to generation. It's special. Only Moshe Rabbeinu made it. I once gave a whole lecture about it. I don't even remember all the details about it. But it was until one generation of one of the kings that mentioned in the Tanakh that we knew that it's there. I don't know, maybe it's passing from father to son. It could be somewhere in the world, we don't know. That every father before he died, give it to one of his children and say, when you die, make sure you pass it to your children and to your children. Maybe there's a family who still have it. Probably not, it's gone from the world. But same thing, the red cow ashes. That was transferred from generation to generation. Once Now, once we have this oil, it's called Shemen HaMishcha. Mishcha means to smear. Once we have this oil, we have mitzvah number 108 in the Torah that we're not allowed to use it only for the Kohanim. What the oil that Moshe Rabbeinu prepared, remember, there was no kings in Israel yet. No kings. So it was used only to make someone a Kohen Gadol, or it's because the Torah says, Al Besar Adam lo Isach, don't use it. And if you use it, it's one of the 36 restrictions that the Torah said that the soul get cut out of my eternity. No share to the world to come. For using this holy oil for an ordinary person. Rabbi, my hands are very dried. It's no lotion. But the pharmacy have lotion. Rabbi, give me some Moshe. No, give some, a little bit. Let me, you know, my hands are itching. Look, they're all dry. Dry skin, no cosmetic. He took a drop, he went like this, finished. No share to the world to come. Why? It's not a lotion, my friend. It's a special holy oil. Mitzvah number, I think we should just do the next two because it's short and we remember that we finished by 110. Mitzvah number 109. No person has permission to do this oil on his own for regular. So, okay, wait. You say to Moshe that he's not allowed to give me his oil. Fine. And I'm not allowed to use his oil if he came to my hand accidentally. But I want to make my own oil. I want to make. That's not allowed to make. Whatever the ingredients that they put inside with the oil and all that, you're not allowed to do it. Remember, also they used to take from this oil and put it on the tools of Bet HaMikdash. They put it and it makes it holy. But a person is not allowed to make his own oil. And the last mitzvah from today, 110, not to make ktoret, all these ingredients that I told you, the spices, that looks like the ktoret. When a person wants to do it to himself, you want to take cinnamon, you want to take all the spices, levona, atzori, v'atziporin, v'achelbona, v'levona. You take the sizes that the Torah say, and you want to make it for yourself. You come to his house. Moshe, your house is like paradise. What a smell. Not allowed. It's not to have perfume in a house. So if a person does it, also a violation of the Torah. This is it, mitzvah number 110. Bezrat Hashem, try to remember that for next Monday, we arrive to 110. Because by me, after what I go through, I don't remember where we... With Rabbi's Bloom help today, he reminded me that we stopped at 95. Remember 110. Baruch Adonai l'olam, amen v'amen.